I welcome you to the Arima Seventh-day Adventist Church. We are situated at number 19 Gannes Street, Arima, in Trinidad. And today, we are welcoming you to our virtual as well as our live worship service. God bless you as you enjoy this experience here at Arima Seventh-day Adventist Church, a place you can call home.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to another installment in the Grace-Filled Family Series. I trust that you have been enjoying the wonderful sermons by our pastor. But before we begin, we, as is customary, we always like to acknowledge God's presence with us. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes. Our Father in heaven, we are so grateful to you for your mercies and your love extended to us yet again. We have been reminded that Grace-Filled Families is all about you extending your grace, your love, your mercy towards us, even when we don't deserve it. And Father, as we receive your love, your grace, your mercy, we want to extend the same to others with whom we come into contact. We recognize, Lord, that our families may be dysfunctional. We may not be all in all that you want us to be. And we pray, dear Father, that you would bless parents, you would bless children, Lord. And as we receive of your love, your mercy, and your grace, we pray, dear God, that we would create better families, better societies, better churches and schools. Be with the proceedings this evening, O Lord. May you bring us a blessing, dear God, that we stand in need of. We pray for our manservant, the speaker, even Pastor Horrell, that as he speaks, O Lord, that we would be transformed through the renewing of our minds and through the power of your Holy Spirit. Be with the proceedings this evening, dear Father. And at the end of it, may your name be honored and glorified, we pray, in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen.
Good evening to each and every one of you. I stand here elated knowing that God is our maker and our King. So please sing that hymn with us, My Maker and My King.
Friends, all my blessings flow. what a mighty God we serve. The angels fall before him, heaven and earth adore him. What a mighty God we serve. I am delivered, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
I am delivered, glory to his name. I was lost and set in the valley of death. I am delivered, praise the Lord. I am delivered, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
I am delivered, glory to his name. I was lost and set in the valley of death. I am delivered.
Amen, amen. We want to thank our priest, him in a special way. We indeed could have gone on another time. Karina, how do you think?
I believe so. You know, I was just rocking to the music and it was just so really, really vibesy.
Oh yes, yes. I enjoyed myself. Amen, amen. That really nice jazz tune. Again, thanks to the priest team for blessing our hearts in such a wonderful way.
And we want to welcome you this evening to the grace-filled families right here at Arima SDA Church.
So before we get any further, we want to say a marvelous Monday evening to all our friends who are here and who are online. If you are happy to be here, say amen.
I'm hearing the crowd and they are saying amen loud and vibrantly.
All 100 of you, the hundreds of you inside this packed church this evening. And the thousands of you who are online, do remember to like and share this video so that this message can go all over the world.
Indeed. You know, today was Monday. We spoke about it yesterday. Persons were preparing for school. The traffic, some persons were saying, you know, I'm going to get up extra early to reach the work on time because those children coming out going to mess up the roads. But we just want to thank God that we have education in this country.
Praise God.
And our children can go to school.
Praise God.
And, you know, kids, if you are viewing this evening, we want you to check in on the chat. Parents, if you are organizing lunch for tomorrow, check in on the chat. Give us a hello. Tell us hello. Good night.
Karina, you know, I understood school was supposed to open today, but many schools didn't actually open today.
Is that so?
Yes, and so I'm sure that there were many young people. I would have probably been one of them who were excited for yet another day. Our August vacation
rest extended. And relaxation.
Yes, yes,
reflection.
Yes. But again, they are out tomorrow, so best of luck to them as they begin their pursuit in education. Remember, God requires us to develop all of our faculties and our minds being one of the greatest assets we have. For those of you
I'm licking my lips here right
who
now.
Who missed out last night. Last night's treat, I am sorry for you.
Oh boy.
That hot chocolate was to die for.
Listen to me. When that thing touched my taste buds, brother Jaden. I tasting all kind of spices and thing in there, you know.
Yes, yes,
old time style. You know?
And I'm looking here and I'm only seeing person smiling in agreement.
Oh yes.
They enjoyed that hot chocolate. You know, that hot chocolate reminded me, it gave me, I don't want to say a spirit blow, but it took me back. You know, I started to remember my grandmother.
Wow.
Oh yes, oh yes, my grandmother was Guyanese. You didn't know that?
Yes, I knew that.
Oh yeah, my grandmother is Guyanese. She made a really nice hot chocolate. We indeed had a wonderful time here at the Arima Seventh-day Adventist Church. And we want to make you jealous online. Because we want you to come right down here at the Gannes Street at the Arima Seventh-day Adventist Church, where we can commune together, where we can enjoy each other's presence, and of course, be blessed by the presence of God in our midst.
Oh yes, so at this time we have a call to action.
A call to action.
Do you know what I'm talking about?
Well, yes, a call to action, friends of mine who are online. Every night, night after night, when you hear us say a call to action, we have things that we would like you to do.
Oh yes.
We want you to share the message. We want you to do what?
Share the message.
Oh yes, we want you to
share the message. What do you mean by that?
Share the link of this video.
Oh, okay.
Yes, you can put it on your WhatsApp statuses. You can put it on your stories on Facebook, on Instagram. You can share it. You can just send it direct to your neighbor, to your friend, your uncle, your tante, your nan, and everybody. Tut bagay. Just share the message. We want you to like this video as it promotes it in the YouTube algorithm. And we want you to turn up that volume. Karina, tell them why we want them to turn up the volume.
We want you to turn up the volume because, as we said, you know, persons might be preparing for school tomorrow, cooking in the kitchen. Some persons might be ironing their uniform or their work clothes. And we want everyone to hear what is going on this evening.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes, indeed. We ask you to turn up the volume. You indeed can be a digital evangelist.
Oh, yes.
You can have a little open air at home right now. Mm-hmm. Oh, yes. All those who are in the hearing of your device may be able to be blessed. But as we move quickly on into the program, we just want to do a quick roll call. We know many of you come here night after night, and we are looking online to see if you are here. Just type present in the chat if you hear your name call. And if an individual is missing, somebody call them. So we have roll call time now. Jennifer Jack, are you present?
I saw that she was most present in the chat already.
Oh yes, oh yes. Donna St. Bernard, Carol St. Bernard, Keisha Renwick, Angela Francis. Karina, I'll allow you to do this one.
Aniela Vanessa Casido Castro.
All right, Henrietta Brumble, Petronella Augustus, Margaret Scipio, are you all present?
Ingrid Anderson, Rose Sank, Sherian Daniel, Claudia Daniel, Kyla Rush, Rhoda Daniel, Sarah Torres, and Jennifer Ramcharita.
All right, so if you were looking at the chat, so if you are present with us, please just type present so that you can be accounted for right here at the Arima Seventh-day Adventist YouTube channel.
You know, I have another question this evening.
Another question. Let's hear it.
I know now is not the time for question and answer, but I hope you can answer this one. Who was the best female finance lady in the Bible?
I don't know.
Pharaoh's daughter. She went down to the bank of the Nile and drew out a little profit. See, people are cracking up here. You see, some persons are getting into relationships for profit and not the P-R-O-P-H-E-T, as Pastor Horrell said, but the monetary profit of relationships.
Wow.
So if you want to know how to build your grace-filled families, a strong foundation, tune in tonight, because
tonight we have a really wonderful topic. You would want to find out if, I don't know if Pastor would answer the question, if persons coming in relationships for profit and to go down to the bank and all these things. But tonight's topic, nonetheless, is hot, sexy, and single. You have a last few moments here, the last few moments, just to share this to somebody who you think may be hot, sexy, and single, or if you yourself think you are, then you definitely want to tune in tonight to hear what the Word of God is saying to us tonight. And of course, tune in night after night at 7 p.m. But Karina, we have a question and answer segment coming up. And persons have been sending in their questions. And I am excited to hear how Pastor is going to answer this question. And if you are excited, the question says, Pastor, I got married in 2007. But even before that time and time again, I have broken my commitment so many times I have lost count. I know I was wrong and I don't want to hurt my wife any longer. But I can't stop. Is there hope for me?
Wow.
We want to hear Pastor answer that question shortly. But before Pastor comes to answer that question,
we have our special music by none other than our dear sister, Sister Akisha Akul. Over to you.
I get on my knees.
Amen. We want to thank God for that wonderful, beautiful, applicable message and song this evening from Amen. Sister Akul.
I don't know how, but there's power when I'm on my knees.
Amen.
Praise God, praise God. Well, our evangelist, our preacher, Pastor Horrell is here with us, and he's ready to answer those burning questions that are on our hearts. Friends, do remember to put your questions in the chat. Because we had picked them up and sent them to Pastor, who would answer them night after night. So without further ado, good evening, Pastor.
Good evening.
Good evening. Our first question, Pastor, it goes as follows. Pastor, last night you said marriage is not supposed to make you happy, but to make you holy. How is that so when there are many couples who are not religious, but their relationship is so much better than some couples in the church? Oh yes. So while we sort out those technical challenges, we want to say thank you to all of you who are joining us online for these questions and answers. And we indeed saw that many of you are present.
Yes, we have some very obedient students. We see Jennifer Jack is present, Donna San Bernard, Rhoda Daniel, and we have new persons, Natalie Perez Antwine. Your friend, Sister Castro, also indicated yes. that she was present.
I'm seeing also Pastor is saying that he's present, although his name wasn't called at the roll call.
Pastor Kurt
but
Thomas.
He is present here. And praise God for that. We'll have to add him to the roll call for tomorrow.
And new persons like Sister Avalyn Douglas, my good friend. And I see Sister Roma Central is on.
Oh, yes.
And Sister Angela Francis. Sister Jennifer Ramcharta always on. And we swing right back to Pastor Horrell as he continues to answer this important question.
Yes, so friends of mine, just a reminder for that question. Persons, Pastor said last night that marriage is not supposed to make you happy, but to make you holy. And the question is, how is that so? When persons who are not religious seem to be so much more happy than couples in the church.
Mm. Okay, good night, everyone. And good night to Jaden and Karina.
Good night, Pastor.
Thank you for your question. Very good question. Now, there are many persons who are moralists. They believe in morals. They believe in values. But they are not attached to any religious group. Or some of them don't really even believe in God. And so there is some measure of harmony in marriage, in their marriages. But what we are talking about is not behavior modification, all right? People can change their behaviors and get good results from their relationships. What we are talking about is transformation, a change of heart. That's what we are talking about. Because what you really need is the values that come out of the heart, all right? So when the heart is transformed by the grace of God, it makes a difference, and it's only God who can really change hearts. God says, he promises that he will put a new heart within us. He will take out the stony hearts from our flesh and give us hearts of flesh, so that hearts that are impressionable to the influence of the Holy Spirit. And that is what we are talking about. So that people who are religious but who are not enjoying that kind of relationship with their spouses and in their families, it simply means that they have not experienced Jesus.
Okay.
And they need to experience Jesus. They need to receive him and his righteousness so that the Holy Spirit can begin to operate in their lives and bring about the transformation that is so needed to bring about change. Change. True heart change. And that's what we want to see in relationships. And it happens because God's grace is powerful. Amen. God's grace is powerful. Grace isn't only just for forgiveness, but grace also provides enablement and empowerment. And that's what we want to have. Not just behavior modification. Not just going through the externals, but what touches the heart. All right? And that's what God's grace does. Next question.
Amen, amen. Thank you so much, Karina.
The next question says, Pastor, I got married in 2007, but even before that time and after, I have broken my commitment so many times I have lost count. I know it is wrong, and I don't want to hurt my wife any longer, but I can't stop. Is there hope for me?
Yes, there is abundant hope for you.
Amen.
You know, sounds like that person has an addiction to sex, and the power of God is also able to deliver from addiction. In fact, tonight I'll talk a little more about that, so I wouldn't want to get into the details of it. So keep tuned in, and I'm sure that you'll get the answer to that question. But there is hope. You know, the Bible says, though your sins be as
scarlet,
they shall be as white as snow. All right? That much I'd say right now. Next question.
So the next question and the final question for tonight goes as follows. Pastor, you spoke about forgiveness, but my husband hurt me so many times. I am just waiting for the right time to leave him. How can I get out of this marriage?
Wow. Well, that's painful. I can hear the pain of that person who is asking the question. You want to know how to get out. Well, you know, I think you know, if you really want to get out, I think you know how to get out. But I'm encouraging you to think carefully and pray carefully about this. Except if it is a case where you have a serial adulterer on your hands, you know. And some spouses could be serial adulterers. You know, the Bible does express displeasure against divorce, but Jesus said if there is adultery, and not just one time adultery, but continuing adultery, then the provision is made for divorce. But the first option is always forgiveness. All right? The first option is always forgiveness and seeking help. Seeking help. But some people have been hurt so deeply because of the habit, you know, that has been developed, and the adultery continues over and over, that the pain is too much, all right? And they just can't trust anymore. Well, if you are in that position, then what can I say? Then you can use that option. But as I would encourage you to think carefully and get help before you make that final decision, that final determination. All right? I'll be praying for you. Well, I think these are all the questions we have for tonight. So we'll have our theme song from the praise team at this time. Thank you.
with your presence. You alone are worthy of your reverence. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord.
That this program is aired and live streamed. Thank you very much. I'm hearing myself now. So I thank God for your sacrifice. Let's bow our heads for prayer before we get into God's word. Holy Father, once again we come in the name of Jesus, giving thanks for the opportunity to share your word. But we dare not begin to do so without the assurance that your Holy Spirit will take charge. So, Lord, bless your word this evening to every heart. Be with all the singles out there and be with all family members, even all the married folks, all the children and young people. Oh, Lord, open their hearts and make them receptive to your word this evening. And may we follow you wherever you lead us tonight, because we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. And amen. You know, we live in a society that wants us to believe that sex is just something physical. That it's like food. So if you are hungry, you eat. Or like a sport that you're good at and you enjoy, so you play. And because of this belief that sex is just physical, the idea of having strict rules about sex seems harsh. Because if certain kinds of sex are a crime, then they are like crimes without victims. But let me ask you some questions. If sex is just physical, why is rape so much more harmful to a woman than simply being beaten up? Women will report physical abuse much more than they will report rape. If sex is just physical, why is it that when a child is sexually abused, when they become an adult and begin to connect the dots, and the emotional wound affects them for years afterwards? Why? And it's not because or just because an authority figure betrayed them. No, that wound goes much deeper. If sex is just physical, why is adultery so devastating to a relationship? And why is it that men with the deepest sexual issues often had fathers who were not involved in their lives or were absentee fathers? Why? If sex is just physical, why is it that most people's greatest regrets are usually sexual? You see, everything in our experience screams out that sex is not just physical. Something much greater and deeper is at work. I want to refer you to Proverbs 5th chapter. Now, in the book of Proverbs, there are a lot of counsel, godly counsel about sex. And by the way, this counsel comes from a man who ought to know. Solomon, King Solomon. He had over 300 concubines, you know. So he ought to know about this. And he said eventually that all is vanity. But I want to read from Proverbs chapter 5, from verse 19. Solomon says, "Drink water from your own cistern and running water from your own well. Should your fountains be dispersed abroad, streams of water in the streets? Let them be only your own and not for strangers with you. Let your fountain be blessed and rejoice with the wife of your youth. As a loving deer and a graceful doe, let her breasts satisfy you at all times and always be enraptured with her love." Now, you might not understand how much this passage was against the culture of those times. You see, in ancient cultures, there were only two reasons people got married. Firstly, economics. You married strategically into another family for the family's security, that they could become wealthier. And secondly, you married to have children. But here you have Solomon talking about sexuality in terms of finding pleasure and erotic delight in a partner that you've given yourself to for life. In Proverbs chapter 2 and verse 17, he calls a wife the companion of your youth. And the word, the Hebrew word halap, which is translated companion, means something like soulmate. But the idea of sex with your spouse being a delight was unheard of in the time of Solomon, far beyond how Solomon's culture saw sex. Another passage where he talked about this again is Proverbs chapter 30 and verse 18, where he says, "Three things are too wonderful for me, four I do not understand." Now this is called a 3-4 poem in Hebrew, and it was a literary device used to express wonder. He said, "Three things are awesome, but the fourth blows me away." By the way, that word wonderful is the Hebrew word palo, which means mysterious, incomprehensible, almost divine. And it is the same word that is used in the book of Isaiah, chapter 9, verse 6, where the name of Jesus, it says his name shall be called Wonderful. And Solomon says, three things are too wonderful for me. The same word. Now, according to verse 19, the three things are the way of an eagle in the sky, the way of a serpent on a rock, and the way of a ship on the high seas. Now, the air is mysterious, invisible, but the eagle glides effortlessly through it. The snake has no legs, but it slithers magically up the face of a rock. How does that work? And then a ship weighing thousands of pounds sails across the top of the ocean. These things to other creatures seem like magic, but there is a special design, a mysterious design at work. But then he comes to number four, his big ultimate mystery, which he says is the way of a man with a virgin. Now, Solomon is saying here that you don't, something here that you don't want to miss. Just like the air, the sea, and the face of a rock seem unmanageable to most creatures, so the woman also is mysterious and unmanageable. But just as the eagle seems to mysteriously work in the air, so there is a wonderful mystery taking place between a man and a woman in a sexual relationship. Now, the next image in verse 20 is deliberately jarring because he says, this is the way of an adulteress. She eats and wipes her mouth and says, I have done no wickedness. Now, here by contrast, you have a woman for whom sex is like sloppy eating. She says, I had an appetite, I ate. And after I'm done, I wipe my mouth and get rid of the traces. In other words, it was just a snack. And there was no deep mystery here. But that totally missed the incredible wonder that God built into sex. You see, in sex, the two become one. Now, physically, you can imagine that. But that oneness that he's talking about is to be achieved in a context where everything else in their lives has also become one. I don't know if you understand what I'm talking about. There's a kind of oneness that takes place in the sexual relationship that is holistic. Yes, you see, in marriage, your lives have become one. Your finances have become one. Your families are one. Your futures are one. But sex outside of that oneness separates the physical oneness from all the other areas of oneness. So what you are saying to the person is, I don't really want all of you yet. At least, I'm not willing or ready to commit my all to you yet. I just want your body for now. You know, C.S. Lewis had a great analogy for this. He says, the guy who wants to have sex with a girl without marrying her feels about the girl the same way the bulimic person feels about food. How does the bulimic person feel about food? The bulimic person loves the taste of food. It brings pleasure and comfort to them. But they don't want to carry around the calories and fat of the food in their body. So they taste it and then they vomit it back out. And that's exactly what the guy having sex outside of marriage is doing. He is saying, I love the taste of you, but I don't want all of you yet. So we'll have sex, but I won't fully unite myself to you. You know, some people may say, well, I'm not married to my partner, but I love them. I do want all of them. Then why haven't you gotten married yet? I'm not saying you don't love them or you are not on the same level of commitment to them, but just admit that you haven't given yourself to them yet. And you and I both know that as committed as you feel today, you are also retaining the right to walk away from her at any given time. Because there's no commitment. Let me be very clear on this, since there is some confusion. According to God's word, sex before you have made that lifelong commitment is sin. That means during the serious dating stage, during the engagement stage, That kind of oneness is only to be experienced after the indissoluble covenant of marriage has been made. Now, someone may be saying, okay, I get it. Sex is better in marriage. But what's the big deal if we have a little fun experimenting? It's just human nature. But you see, because you are human and not an animal, it is more than just nature. Recently, a couple of neurologists who were not Christians, they published a scientific study called Hooked, in which they showed what having multiple sexual partners does to your brain, especially when you are young. These scientists say in their study they discovered that it actually rewires your brain. When you have multiple sexual partners, it actually rewires your brain in a way that makes genuine, lasting, selfless relationships much more difficult. They said, the individual who goes from sex partner to sex partner is causing his or her brain to mold in such a way that eventually accepts that sexual pattern as normal. The pattern of changing sex partners, therefore, damages their ability to bond in a committed relationship. The kind of attachment damage caused by repeated sexual encounters is, in many respects, more devastating than unwanted pregnancies or STDs. Repeated sexual encounters hinder our abilities to form lifelong and satisfying relationships. And they concluded, you can no more try out sex than you can try out birth. The very act of sex produces a new reality that cannot be undone. End quote. So it's damaging. It's damaging to your brain because you are rewiring your brain in such a way that you can't commit to a serious relationship. So you must continue the addiction. And maybe the person who asked the question earlier on tonight, is because of the serial sexual pattern. That person's brain has been rewired. But you know, these are non-Christians and they say it cannot be undone, but thank God it can be undone. There's nothing that God cannot do. Now let me talk here about the damage of pornography. Because this has become a popular pastime even among church folks, both single and married. Looking at pornography, perhaps to an even greater extent, kills your capacity for lifelong satisfying relationships. First, it causes you to start looking at the opposite sex as a commodity, something to be used. Let me talk to men specifically, though this issue plagues both men and women. When you gaze at pornography, you are looking at an image of a woman whose body you just want to use. And that trains your mind to see women as objects. And that's how you start to relate to women, as objects. When you look at pictures of women without recognizing their souls, your mind starts to see real women in your life as objects to be used. Now, someone may be saying, well, Pastor, that's not so because I can keep it separate. But that's where you're wrong, because looking at porn also rewires your brain. That's why men, if you are indulging in pornography, you need to get rid of it today for the sake of your relationship with all future women. That's why you need to immediately erase from your playlist songs which refer to a woman as a bitch or a whore. Because the way you train your mind to think about women is the way you will begin to see them. Remember the scriptures in Proverbs chapter 23, verse 7 says, as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. Now the second thing pornography does is destroy your own capacity for sexual fulfillment. Was Andy Stanley, who says that every time you look at porn, you rewire your soul to believe three things. three things. That a real body is not good enough. That's the first. Secondly, that one body alone isn't good enough. And thirdly, that your wife's body is not good enough. You see, no woman, no matter how beautiful, no woman can live up to what you see in porn. Stanley says, no man has ever gorged himself on porn and then put it behind him after marriage because his wife met all his porn fantasies. Instead, the opposite happens. So men, if you are not willing to address this in your life, then I challenge you to tell your girlfriend or your fiancé that you are bringing all these three things with you into the relationship and that she will never be able to satisfy you. Tell her that now and give her the option to opt out of the relationship before you break her heart later. You know, I directed a lot of this issue toward men, but in our society, it has become just as much a problem for women. Many of the movies today have made soft porn become mainstream for women. But these things are not romantic. They are destroying you. So if you took your wife to see any of those movies, you need to ask God for the gift of repentance and seek forgiveness from your wife. Now, at this time, there may be some of you feeling overwhelmed because you have made those kinds of mistakes. Or maybe you feel trapped in them now. But I'm saying to you tonight that the blood of Jesus can make you purer than before you sinned. And the resurrection of Jesus can make your soul more whole and alive and healthy than before you fell. You see, sin defiles you and stains your soul. But as the songwriter says, oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. I want to give you some hope tonight. Jesus invites you in Isaiah 1:18. He says, come now, and let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, they shall be as wool. Jesus shed his blood so that you can receive forgiveness. But that's not all. He didn't only die, but he was raised to life for your justification. And do you know what that means? It means that when you receive Jesus as your Savior and you have faith in him, he justifies you. At that very moment, he not only forgives you, but he transfers his holy life to you so that you have a clean record. You know, it's just like somebody who has been accused of a crime. And they are charged in court for the crime. But the judge says, finds them not guilty. Now, immediately, that person's criminal record is expunged, right? All the crimes. He now has a clean record. So if he goes for a police record, it wouldn't reflect any of those things because he has been declared not guilty. And so the same thing happens because we come into the world contrary to God, separated from God, with a nature that's hostile to God. And so we come into the world under condemnation. But when we receive Jesus in our lives and he forgives us and washes us in his blood, he then justifies us. And immediately he justifies us, his righteousness is transferred to us. So as far as God is concerned, we are righteous. He considers us righteous, even though in ourselves we are still sinners, but he considers us righteous. And do you know something? At that very moment, he says, now you are not under condemnation any longer. But immediately the Holy Spirit comes into your life to make you a new creature. In fact, 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. All things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. And then Romans 6:3-4. It says, or do you not know that as many of us as were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore, we were buried with him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. Hallelujah. So we were baptized into his death. And that simply means that as far as God is concerned, the death of Jesus Christ is considered as if we were the ones who died. But that's not all. We were also raised to life through his resurrection. We are resurrected with him. We are united to him. So that means we have access to the power of God. We have access to his resurrection power. So there is abundant hope. But then there's another text I want to give you. Hebrews 7, 24 and 25. It says, but he, because he continues forever, has an unchangeable priesthood. Therefore, he is also able to save to the uttermost those who come to God through him, since he lives to make intercession for them. Did you get that? He's also able to save to the uttermost. That means to the fullest extent. You may think that there's utter hopelessness for you, but he is still able to save to the uttermost as you come to God through Jesus Christ. You see, Jesus was crucified so that his blood could wash away the deepest sin. And when God resurrected him from the dead, he clearly demonstrated that he can put back together anything broken by sin. But repentance is necessary. Now, so far I've spoken about how we undervalue sex. But I want us to consider now how we overvalue sex. Because there's that kind of belief in society where sex is overvalued. Proverbs 11:22. It says, like a gold ring in a pig's snout is a beautiful woman without discretion or character. Now, this is Solomon at his finest. Here you have a gold ring, but the problem is that it is attached to a pig, a big old nasty pig. But the guy wants the ring so bad, he figures he'll put up with the hog as long as he gets the ring. So every night he has the satisfaction of having this ring, but he's got to sleep with this nasty hog in his bedroom. You may be saying, What idiot would do that? And Solomon says, the person who thinks that sex and beauty are everything would do that. You see, our culture overvalues sex and beauty, making a whole lot of people today believe that we can't have a good life without them. Firstly, many folks today feel like physical beauty is all that matters, and all that gives a person value. A lot of people put way too much emphasis on physical looks when they are dating. So they will settle for hog-like character if they get the gold ring of physical beauty. Men, you would do well to remember this. When Proverbs 31 described the ideal woman, the woman who blesses you year after year, and your children call her blessed, it never talked about beauty. Notice Proverbs chapter 31, verse 30, it says, charm is deceptive and beauty is fleeting, but a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. You see, beauty is good, but character is better. Some women think physical beauty is so important that they feel worthless without it. So they spend a lot of time and energy and resources trying to look beautiful. But if you worship beauty, one day it's going to come back to haunt you, because when you lose it, you're going to be devastated. And you know how beauty can fade fast, right? And a lot of girls will do really destructive things to their bodies to try and look good. That's why anorexia and bulimia are so popular among young ladies today. Because these eating disorders come about because many young ladies assume that their primary beauty and identity are established by their shape and their size. Did you know that eating disorders are 3 to 5 times higher among women of industrialized nations than among non-industrialized nations? They are 2 times higher among college students within those nations than they are among women at large. This means that the closer you get to the heart of Western civilization, the more women are bombarded with the message that all that matters about you is your looks. And your character doesn't matter. That's why a lot of women get depressed as they age. When their physical beauty is gone, their identity and their happiness go with it. You see, their physical beauty was all they had. Physical beauty is good, but a person who walks with God has a beauty that lasts forever. Now, another way we overvalue sex is we are convinced that the good life is impossible without romance and sex. And we are willing to give up anything to have that. This is why you'll find a guy in his 50s leaving his lifelong companion and his kids for a younger, sexier woman, even though it destroys his family and his finances. You see, he is thinking at all costs, I've got to have that ring. Who cares about the hug of a ruined family? You know, I read recently of a guy who listed out all the things that would happen if he committed adultery. And this is what he said. Here's what he wrote. He says, I would cause untold hurt to my wife. And I would have to endure the loss of her respect and trust. And would likely forfeit my relationship to her. I would cause deep hurt to my 4 children who would never understand why I traded them for a thrill. My relationship with them would never be the same. I would bring shame on my mother and father and shame and endless judgment on the girl I commit adultery with. I would cause shame to my church family. I would enable the laughter and blasphemous smugness of my non-Christian professors to disrespect God and mock him in the classroom. I would follow in the footsteps of men I know whose immorality forfeited their ministry and caused me to shudder with horror. Most importantly, I would grieve my Lord and Savior. And one day I will have to look him in the face and explain why, after all he had given me and after all the beauty he put into my life, I had to have something else. It's just not worth it. Well, someone may be wondering, I have sinned sexually. Can't I be forgiven? Yes, you can. Like I said, the power of God's grace is amazing. Amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. But you of all people should want people to understand how devastating and powerful these things are. And I feel like some of you may be here for me to warn you. The gold ring of beauty is not worth it. Some of you are forfeiting your soul. This is the issue that keeps many young people from surrendering their lives to God. Don't forfeit your soul for this. Some people overvalue sex in that they feel like they couldn't be happy if they are not married. Or if they are married, that they need to have a different marriage, a better one, to be happy. They always find themselves envying other people's relationships. And imagining how much better they would be in a new situation. Beauty and sex are good, but they are not the most important things. You see, life is found only in a relationship with God. Are you listening to me? And not in sex. Think about this. The most joyful, fulfilled, fully alive person who ever lived was single and a virgin. And according to Isaiah 53:2, he had no form or comeliness. And when we see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. In other words, he was not that physically attractive. But he was secure in the love of his father. And it was in his father's love and not in marriage or in bed that he found fulfillment and pleasures forevermore. You see, the arms you are looking for in romance are God's arms. The love you seek is his love. It's just that you don't know it. So you're looking for happiness and beauty and romance and all the rest of it, satisfaction in the wrong places. But they're going to cost you. Because beauty and sex are good, and it is fine to desire them. But you do not need them to live. beauty and sex are good, but the love of Jesus is better. And notice, when you are alive to him, when you are alive in him, you will be free of the captivity to sex. How can you be free? Well, I want you to listen to what Proverbs chapter 6, verses 23 to 25 says. It says, "For the commandment is a lamp, and the law a light. Reproofs of instruction are the way of life, to keep you from the evil woman, from the flattering tongue of a seductress. Do not lust after her beauty in your heart, nor let her allure you with her eyelids." So how can you be free from the sexual desire that's consuming your life? You need to get captured by the love of God. The way to escape the captivity of sexual desire is to be taken in by a stronger captivity. So how do you escape the captivity of sexual desire? It's not just by working up your willpower. You are freed from sexual captivity by being taken into a greater captivity, captivity to the love of God. The arms you seek are his arms. Your soul is thirsty, but it's not ultimately for human love. It's for God's love. Without him, you will be in a sea of loneliness, even though you have all the things that you thought would satisfy you and bring you happiness. Sexual captivity, as much as any other, reveals what is broken. If you are unhappy, chances are that it is somehow connected to this. If you feel broken, it's likely that it's connected to this. If you are weighed down by guilt, chances are that it's connected to this. You see, a lot of people have been damaged and broken by sexual abuse, by sexual promiscuity, and by sexual sin. But I want you to know that Jesus understands and identifies with your pain. Did you hear what I said? You see, Jesus was sexually objectified and assaulted when he was stripped naked on the cross for us. Did you hear what I said? Oh yes, Jesus. The pictures that you see of Jesus on the cross, the paintings, don't represent the reality of what happened. He was stripped naked. And he was made a sexual object of ridicule. That's why darkness came down that Friday afternoon to cover the nakedness of the Son of God. You see, being crucified naked was a calculated aspect of his torture. It was an intentional compounding of the shame and humiliation of the cross. Those in power were proving their dominance by displaying the sexuality of their victim. So his humanity was diminished by the exposing of his body for the pleasure of others as they gambled away his tattered dignity. But I'm telling you tonight that Jesus willingly submitted himself to this inhumane treatment to offer hope to all those who have been sexually abused. Are you listening to me? To all those who have been sexually assaulted and turned into a sexual object. He was made a sexual object for you. So if you are a victim of sexual abuse, of sexual assault, or you have been made into a sexual object, you can look to Jesus and know that the shame you feel and the guilt that haunts you has been absorbed by a God who knows and cares for the victim, and that restoration and resurrection await all those who trust in him. Hallelujah. And Jesus did this to warn abusers that he is on the side of all the victimized, that he shares your pain, and that he will have justice on people who harm those for whom he died. But Jesus also endured all of this to forgive abusers. Oh yes, even though it is hard to think about forgiveness for abusers. You see, Jesus died at the hands of abusers precisely so he could extend grace to all those who have committed the worst of crimes. And you remember that among the final words of Jesus on the cross were the words in Luke 23:34, "Father, forgive them. So he prayed for his abusers. You see, the gospel assures us that Jesus lived and died and was resurrected so he could liberate us from emotional hurt, pain, brokenness, guilt, shame through the gift of his forgiveness and his righteousness. God raised him from the dead, showing that he can heal any brokenness, and his love can satisfy your soul tonight. Did you get that? He died so you could receive forgiveness. He rose again so you could receive healing, emotional healing. Oh yes, healing from the hurt and the pain of all the abuse. Healing from your brokenness. His love satisfies your soul. It's a gift you must receive, because it's not what you do that matters, but it's receiving what he has done. That's what matters. So how many of you want to receive him tonight? How many of you want to receive his love and forgiveness tonight? How many of you want to have your brokenness healed tonight? You want to have peace? Oh yes. You want the shame to go away. You want hope to your broken spirit. Do you want that tonight? Well, if you do, I want you to know I want to pray specially for you. Because I know that there are many who are hurting tonight. Because they have been victims of all kinds of sexual abuses, rape. You name it. There are so many victims out there. But I want you to know that Jesus understands your pain. He identifies with your pain, and he wants to bring about your healing. So if you've heard his voice tonight, and you want to say to him, Jesus, have mercy upon me. Just like that woman who was set up and caught in the act of adultery, he wants to say to you tonight, neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. Just like Mary, who was also sexually abused, God wants to say to you tonight, I hear your cry. I feel your pain. And I want to pour my healing grace into your heart so that you can be delivered from your shame and that you can receive healing from your pain and from your brokenness. So bow your heads right where you are. Those of you who are online, just bow your heads with me also. I want to pray for all the victims tonight. Father in heaven, we give thanks for our Savior, Jesus Christ, who went to the cross and who bore our pain, who was wounded for our transgressions and bruised for our iniquities, who was sexually assaulted on the cross, made a sexual object of shame, stripped naked, taunted and mocked and laughed, so that every victim of sexual abuse, of sexual sin, every victim can know tonight that Jesus feels your pain. He was there, but he bore your griefs and carried your sorrows so that you could receive healing. Tonight, there is healing for all those who are emotionally broken. So have mercy, Lord. We pray that you'll pour your healing grace into each heart to heal the brokenness, to remove the shame, and to set those captives free forever. We even pray for the abusers tonight, that you will have mercy upon them. Oh Lord, may they come face to face with Jesus and with his mercy and grace, and know that Jesus too prayed for them when he was on the cross, because he said, Father, forgive them. We pray also for those who are being held captive to sexual sin, and they don't know how to get deliverance, how to overcome, how to stop it. Oh Lord, we thank you that there's power in the blood of Jesus. We thank you that there's power in the enabling grace of Jesus. We thank you that there's power in the Holy Spirit, resurrection power, to bring about transformation. So Lord, have mercy upon them. And may they too come to you and experience deliverance and healing from their captivity. May the shackles be broken tonight, so that they can be free, set free. For whom the Son sets free is free indeed. And the rest of us, Lord, keep us in love with Jesus. Keep us experiencing his love day by day, so that ultimately we can have the joy of experiencing his eternal love in your kingdom. Because that's what you desire for all of us, that where you are, there we may be also. And we praise you and we give thanks, because we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen.
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 We bless the Lord for that word, that truth, straight from the Bible.
Yes.
Hot, single, and sexy. Or hot, sexy, and single. We know, as Pastor said, don't marry the hog just to get the ring around its neck. Mm-hmm. Which means don't marry a dirty person just for sexual satisfaction.
And I like that Pastor said, fornication and pornography rewires your brain with destructive patterns. What a wonderful message. Feel free to share these messages for those who weren't here tonight. Again, we say thank you to all 80 plus of you.
Oh, yes.
We are getting to our 5,000 mark.
Oh, yes.
Yes, so continue to share the messages, continue to view them, because we believe that they are indeed impactful. To those of you who are live here in church, we thank you in a special way for being here, for coming. My friend down to the back, Brother Tan, good night to you. And to all the rest of you, thanks for being here. To our 80 plus viewers online, Sister Andrea Agarat, Karen and Glenda Romeo, Meryl Dennis, a special good night to you. Roland Williams, Ann Cordner, Ella Copeland, Natalie Perez Antwine, Sister Sita Abdul, Birth Thomas, and Sister Allison Martin, good evening.
Sister Jewel Nyack, Susan Lendor, Margaret Belfon, Anne Baker Jarville, Sandra Seeley, Sheila Liebert, and persons reporting present, Brother McCasey Brooms, Margaret Scipio, Angela Francis.
Well, tonight we had many of you who answered the call, the roll call. You are present and we are glad to have you. Just somebody send a shout out or find out we have someone missing in action tonight.
Oh boy.
Oh yes, the Lessie family, brother and sister Lessie. I don't know if they were online or if they were there, and you can just type present in the chat. But if not, somebody reach out to them. We want to see them here tomorrow night for the roll call. As a matter of fact, we'd put their name on the top of the list.
Oh yes.
For the roll call for tomorrow night. Those are my really good friends, brother and sister Lessie. We say a special good night to you all.
And tomorrow evening's topic is singleness better than marriage? Is singleness better than marriage? Right here, 7 p.m. on the Arima SDA Church's YouTube channel. And we do invite you to come down right here at the Gannes Street, where you can enjoy sweet, sweet fellowship as we continue to enjoy messages from Pastor Horrell on grace-filled families.
Well, it was our pleasure being with you and sharing these moments with you tonight. So we want to thank you once again for inviting us into your homes.
As you invite God into your hearts.
Good night.
Your presence.
we will serve the Lord. Brothers in harmony.